The opinions expressed on the following audio program are solely those of the host and the guests. Burner Podcast is an independently produced, not-for-profit show and is not associated with the Burning Man organization or its subsidiaries. The views expressed are not representative of the entire Burning Man community and are presented here for entertainment purposes only. In short, calm the fuck down. It's just a podcast.
All right. Okay, I'm going to do the intro thing. Let's hope it's under 10 minutes. Hey, it's episode number 140, and as of this particular recording, there are 99 days till the man burns. And I am 14 days into a dopamine reset thing. By the way, do you like how I just got into strobus mode real quick? Like real quick. I am 14 days into a dopamine reset. And also, by the way, it's like 97 days. I just thought 99 sounded better.
Yeah. Nice.
Okay. It's 97 days as of this. Okay.
We like nines.
Yeah. All right. I am 14 days into a dopamine reset thing that I'm doing. Dr. Anna Limke, professor of psychiatry and author of Dopamine Nation, suggests that many of us could benefit from like a 30-day detox. Mm. And I've just been like really into that lately. But for reasons that I will not get into so much today, in order not to waste your time, I went balls to the wall and decided to set my goal for 90 days. The jury is still out on whether or not this is a good idea. But the reason I bring this up is to share this interesting experience that I've had a few times. I have friends and acquaintances whom I've shared this with, not all of them, for the most part people know me, but some have expressed like mild concern. the assumption, and after we talk a little bit, you know, we get into the details of like why they're concerned, but like I realized that the assumption on their end of this very well-meaning person, by the way, being, oh no, have things gotten really that bad for you? Are you battling something severe? Are you having addiction problems? Like, is something really bad happened?
Right.
Which, while I deeply, deeply appreciate the immediate love and support that I get from my friends, it did get me thinking, this and some other experiences that I've had in the past month, because the premise of their concern was something has happened to which I am reacting. Mm-hmm. And I personally this is an important clarification here. I personally happen to be particularly blessed in that my inner circles are densely populated by mental health professionals and healers. And in the bubble that I live in, there is this general, very proactive sense of addressing our mental health. People close to me generally know I'm always like experimenting with some new personal development thing. Trauma-aware conversations are simply just casually had. Mm-hmm. And therapy is not seen as a crutch or a hindrance or a failure, but as a tool. One which pretty much all of us can benefit from. And I've personally always likened having a therapist to having like a personal trainer for my mind. And for 1 hour every week or two, that's like 2 or 3 measly hours a month, I go and I see my trainer to review my workout routine and like give me some pointers and kind of like how I try not to wait until I'm starving before I go grocery shopping. I have learned through enough emotional face plants to be proactive about my mental health because I spent the first half of my life casually suicidal. So my first therapist was kind of like putting in her hours for certification at Mesa Community College Student Health Services. And that experience was so life-affirming that I've since included periods of on and off therapy. And I've done my best to be fairly proactive about it. So this is how today's episode comes in. Episode 131 of this show was a mental health roundtable with the two Kims. And it was a bit more of a top-down, wider scope of vision community angle of mental health topics we could do well to keep some awareness around as a community. And we knew the instant we finished recording that episode that we'd want to do another deeper dive. We were talking about it as soon as we finished recording it. So today's show is going to be a much more personal angle, more about the individual perspective of how we, each of us, alone in our heads, can navigate the world, both default and otherwise, from the best and most balanced personal perspective. the road is bumpy, life has its ups and downs, and it's all about how we do our best to ride those waves, because the waves come whether we like it or not. Today, my guests are Dr. Mayra Gomez Padua and Dr. Mia Sarno, aka Dr. Mimi. Dr. Mimi specializes in psychedelic therapy and research and sees clients on in a private practice in San Diego. Dr. Mayra Gomez Padua is a clinical psychologist with dual specialty in trauma and health psychology and currently works in the Bay Area providing support to individuals with cancer. Both also obviously burners with extensive experience removing playa dust from curious places. Mia and Mayra, those are my guests today. That's what we're getting into. And by the way, that's also a great like sounding pair of names to start a show. I'm just going to put that out there because I try to convince everybody
we can,
I interview.
We can have our own show.
Totally. Uh-huh. Yeah. I try to convince everybody I interview to start their own podcast. That's today's guests. Good sounding pair of names. Today's chat will be all about therapy and what it looks like from the angle of the provider, the challenges and obstacles we all face trying to get therapy, and tools, tips, and ideas we can all implement on our own solo mental health journeys and on our individual wellness path. All of this, of course, from a burner community lifestyle perspective. That's today's focus. And after the chat with Mia and Mayra, we'll be treated to a DJ set by another spectacular mental health provider. Umee Dee is returning to the show. We featured a DJ set from Umee back on episode 123, entitled What a Journey. And we didn't really talk about it on this one. And there wasn't like the slightest hint of doubt that we'd want to have her back on for this episode to use one of her DJ sets, because Umee Dee is a psychiatrist based in Berkeley, California. She's also an assistant professor at UCSF, that's University of California, San Francisco. And you'll love this. Umee's life purpose is to elevate music as the key component of mental wellness practices. She provides ketamine therapy and DJs a personalized set for her patients. A DJ set for an audience of one. Oh, man. A Burning Man DJ set. Oh, yeah. You will. You will. Mayra, you're going to the MAPS conference next
week.
You're both. Oh, my. You're
both.
Awesome. You will meet her there. Awesome. She's giving a talk on MDMA, I think.
Okay.
Yeah. A Burning Man DJ set from Umee Dee is what you'll be hearing after today's chat with Mia and Mayra. So let's dive in. Today's episode is entitled Addiction to Certainty. I go by Mr. Arash, even though nobody calls me Mr. Welcome to Burner Podcast. Actually, probably a good place to start the show, because I had this episode in mind for quite some time, and the title in my head had always been "Why aren't you in therapy?" Because I thought it was like a funny sentence, like "Why aren't you in therapy?" you know, it's burner snark. We're silly. This is what we do. And then on my preparation for this episode, one of the things that I did was I posted on social media asking for folks to pitch in various experiences or thoughts that they've had, opinions that they have about the kinds of challenges that people generally face. Trying to get to see a therapist, to get into therapy.
Yeah.
And there was, of course, like a large, like the biggest outcry was how royally fucked the system is.
Yeah. Yes,
and how hard so many people are trying. Mm. And yeah. I was like, well, I don't want to make it seem like we're making fun of them.
Yeah.
Anyway, whether or not this episode ends up being entitled "Why Aren't You in Therapy," is a part of that. But me and Mayra, thank you so much for being a part of this amazing conversation that we're about to have.
Pleasure. I'm really happy to be here. Thank you so much for having us.
Yeah. Likewise.
Yeah. The system thing. I want to just dive into that like immediately.
Totally.
Mia, when we were chatting on the phone prior to today's recording, like I was sharing this exact thing with you, right? About like how overwhelmingly the outcry was, I am trying to get therapy and I can't because my insurance and because the system and the 2 months wait list and you know all this kind of stuff. And we're going to get into a bunch of these different individual reasons in today's episode. But you, what is it that you said? You said something like, when we get into this conversation of the individual and the systematic problems, it immediately feels incredibly helpless.
Yeah. It can. For all of us, you know, people seeking therapy and the providers. There's just so many things I can say. So I wonder where you want to start with it.
Well, the providers thing, let's start with that immediately. Because someone else actually did mention, a good friend of mine who's not a burner, about, I don't think she's a burner, but I think she mentioned that from like the provider standpoint, dealing with the quagmire of insurance, like a lot of times ends up being so complicated that they'll end up having to accept less patients than they would like or folks that they really feel like this would be like, you know, here's a person I really want to help, but trying to get them through the system is just excruciating.
Yes. Yes. Definitely. That is the consensus. Providers that work in big healthcare systems, there's like admin and people who kind of figure out the insurance piece for you, but definitely some providers who are in private practice, for example, who are trying to deal with insurance. What I hear a lot, I actually don't accept private insurance in my private practice. I am part of a therapy collective, though, that does some insurance overhead for me. So one day of the week, I do accept insurance because I have someone who figures that out for me. For the therapists that I've heard from that are doing this themselves, they talk a lot about the countless hours that they spend on the phone with insurance, trying to fight for, justifying seeing someone for even like five sessions or like a small number of sessions, even though this person is really struggling, and how frustrating it is to have to fight to get them to cover something. Also, those hours aren't paid, so this person is just taking hours out of their day and not making money. And, you know, we have our bills to pay as well. And on the other side of things too, they'll go through all this work trying to get things covered and get a treatment plan approved and things like that. And then when they submit for reimbursement, they don't get reimbursed. Right. And so therapists just then have done all this emotional labor and all this work and taken all this time and care and then don't get paid. Mm-hmm. And it's, I'm just seeing more therapists, have to make a really sad decision and this conflict between I want to be accessible and I want to really help those who, need it. And also I have student loans and bills to pay. And it's such a unfortunate situation that we're in as well. And then there's a whole nother conversation of working within big healthcare systems and the struggles of that and the limitations of that and the red tape and the, all the things.
Yeah.
But I'll pause there.
Yeah. And in speaking from myself who works for a big institution, that, and our efforts is to, increase equity within the healthcare space. So what we are doing is we are able to accept insurances like Medi-Cal, but no, you know, we're having to do grant funding for that because there's no, it's pro bono or low bono work. And, you know, these are individuals that are really struggling in with death and dying since, you know, working with cancer is such an intense process. And how do you work through that? And how do you get support when you have these, when you don't have the access? And so we do our best to provide the little bit of work that we can do within a big institution. And at the same time, like, there's no support for that as much as we would like to. So what do we do with that, right? And how can people be smart consumers of healthcare, but also, like, you know, get the care that, you know, we all need and deserve and would help us grow.
Right. Yeah. I feel like one of the most common themes in the conversations that I have had on this podcast, and it probably has to do with it being specifically something that we as burners are usually navigating. So much of the difficulties of the default world is getting lost in the quagmires of systems and losing sight of individuality. Yeah. So a lot of what happens when we start like interacting with the burner community and going to Burning Man is a re-examination or some level of dissection of those systems, which is why I think it consistently ends up being like a common topic that we explore on this show in one way or another. It's usually people are like, the system is fucking me this way or that way. Right. But how can we bring it back to that individual focus?
Mm-hmm. And our initial inclination. Important. Yeah. Our initial inclination is to be like, fuck the system. Mm. Right. Yeah. Like
For real though.
And then
actually though,
and you also need to know how to play or know how to fuck the system, right? Because if you completely dismiss it, then you're not playing around with like the potential benefits that you can get from playing the game, which is really messed up to say.
No, it's like, how can we acknowledge how fucked it is and also acknowledge that we are operating within it, and we need to figure out how to be within it while we also call out how fucked it is.
Yes.
And it's such a weird, hard balance I find myself trying to maintain like every day.
Yes.
You know?
And like, I feel like in a way we get into this kind of robotic mindset where we're like, fuck the system. There's nothing that's here to support me. So I'm just going to put my self-care and my mental health aside and just live the way that I've always lived, which is go to work and do the things that society has maybe set up for me to do. Mm. And yet we put our mental health and our self-care aside. Mm. And then that shows up in the party spaces as well, right? Sure, when we completely neglect ourselves, not in the best way sometimes.
Yeah, what I'm kind of like hearing a little bit as you're having this conversation is any situation where we go to any extreme side of the spectrum tends to not be beneficial, right? If we get too lost in our own individual experience, or if we completely surrender to any system,
right?
But it's a system. I am certainly not an academic to be able to argue this, but like the thought that comes up for me is that a system need not be inherently evil, but it has the capacity very easily to be used for that, easier than individual experiences, because I think like there's like a number that like, I don't remember this thing. There's like a sociological studies that have been done about how like there's a specific number of people that work really well together, and anything gets past that number.
I think it's like seven. If it's like more than like 8 or 9 or something, then you start to see these like, what do you call it? Like when maybe a leader will start to step in and that starts to kind of influence everybody's decision-making, everybody's thought processes around that. But if you have a group that is not just like on the smaller side, but also diverse,
Yeah.
then you're bringing in perspective, right?
Yeah. Well, living in a world where there's 8 billion of us on the planet, that's going to be challenging to navigate.
A little more than 7.
Yeah, a little bit more. Yeah. But I think that was particularly interesting to kind of, because I wanted to make sure that we kind of hit, you know, this part of it, is that my personal bias, full disclosure for listeners and for everyone, is that I'm Persian. My family's from Iran. I grew up in a culture where there's a lot of people around me, very close to me, who really need like some good therapy. Mm-hmm. But like they have like a strong cultural bias against it. Mm-hmm. And I think because, you know, they see it as like failure.
Yeah.
Like, oh, you're only crazy people. Oh, crazy people go see a therapist. The there's something wrong with you.
Dun, dun, dun.
Yeah.
The label. Yeah. Yeah.
So I think like just an awareness of like, again, my own personal bias is that because I'm aware of that, it's something that I notice more with my non-Iranian friends in my circles and stuff, where like mm-hmm. people who like, I'm like, why aren't you like dealing with this thing? You see that your life is difficult. You have access to therapy. You have the thing, you have the money, you have the insurance, but you're choosing not to go it.
Mm. Do you want to lead this one?
Sure. I can start. So I'm white. And my, dad's side of the family came from Italy. We're pretty, gnarly Roman Catholics and, immigrated here. And my mom's side is from North Dakota and white European background. And honestly, the cultural traditions, I guess, that they picked up, they all really like were dedicated to assimilating to America. My Italian family stopped speaking Italian when they got here and just really tried to be super good Americans. And what does a good American mean? You work, you do is work, you come home and you like have a family dinner. No one talks about feelings. It's just all about work ethic. Yeah. And, so they like, I feel very disconnected to any cultural traditions that I would have been connected to. It was all just about, just working hard. And, I don't really know a lot, about my family history, which is a weird thing to navigate, honestly. But
what
mental health,
you to this? Yeah, to this
yeah,
field.
Mental health was not talked about in my family at all. And this is despite, and if I sound nervous, it's because it's hard for me to say this on a public air because I worry about if my family hears this. But my family is very heavily riddled with mental illness and intergenerational complex trauma and emotional abuse and manipulation and sexual abuse and horrible things. And nobody talked about it. And it was all just hush hush. And like I suffered through that growing up. And what made me interested in mental health was like, I had a few people in my life and my chosen family, you know, my friends and other people's families that I knew who obviously had a different life and they had connection and they had support. And so I knew it was possible. And my sister and I were in that together. We luckily had each other. But, you know, something within us both, she's a physician now, we just knew that it could be different and that other people could experience well-being and connection. And so I just really got interested in finding out what that was and exploring that for myself. And I just really dove into school, dove into exploring my spirituality and studying psychology and things like that. But definitely came from a background where it was like, you know, really awful things happening and you just don't talk about it. You just work and you just get good grades and, you know, it's all about appearance and that's it.
Yeah. Yeah. Gnarly Catholic, I think gives you a good frame of reference of like Iranian as well. Like,
Yeah. I'm curious, you know, the discovery of mental health as someone who maybe like didn't have that accessible, or maybe it's, you know, your parents our parents, I could speak for myself as well, you know, my family did not emphasize on like mental health. That was not part of my experience growing up. So how I found it was through like self-preservation, like and curiosity about my own human experience, right? Like how, you know, who am I as a person? And things that were coming up for me that maybe were intergenerational behaviors that weren't healthy for me. And then through that and, you know, entering into the party space, and then how the do those, does my personality and those like maybe unhealthy attachments and behaviors were kind of showing up in those spaces, and then figuring out, oh, maybe that's not healthy for me. Maybe I should kind of like back off, or maybe I should explore a little bit what this means. And so to me, stepping and exploring with psychedelics and trying different things and coming into the party scene, I'm saying that in quotes because it feels like more like a community, right?
Sure. Yeah.
But through that experience, I felt like I started exploring myself a little bit more, and then finding people within that community. I was like, oh, this is what my self-care means to me. This is what my mental health means to me in a way that maybe wasn't present, like growing up, right? And so I really value the Burning Man community and being there. Just like, to me, it was just, it was kind of an awakening. Like it kind of cracked open my brain and my heart space to be like, wow, like this is what it means to work on myself. And I can still do all the things. I can still party, and I can still take care of myself, and I can still bring that back to the default world.
Yeah.
That's excellent. That was a big chunk of my experience as well. And I'd say it's the dance music underground, because it is community, and a lot of the dance music underground is the freaks, geeks, and weirdos, the LGBTQ community. Yeah. Like
we find our chosen family.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. It's all about chosen family, and like as we navigate that world and we realize, oh, we can choose a family, it brings up exactly those topics for us to explore and go like, why am I doing this thing that I've always done? Because I want to work with this, and I want to dissect sort of like what my identity is and where it comes from. And I want to improve and I want to elevate, rather than, because like so much of like the old family traditions are based on obligation.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
I'm just plugged into this thing. I have to show up to it. I got to take care of this thing, right?
These are the rules.
Yeah. It's funny because Burning Man is like not, you know, I mean, yes, we have the 10 principles and we have all these things that kind of set up the stage.
Yeah.
But there's no rules. When you get out there, there's just like principles.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And coming back to the default world, or living in the default world and then stepping into like the Burning Man space, you're like, wow, like I have to kind of undo those connections that have already been ingrained in me, like that cultural boundaries that we have within ourselves, the stigma of, you know, life. And then how does that show up in the space of like the party community?
Yeah. And it's another system is the thing that we grew up in, because there's so much beauty in culture. Yeah. There's so much beauty in a lot of the experiences that we've had in our upbringing. Now, like, mind you, like we felt, like specifically this circle here, the three of us, like we felt drawn to dissecting it and going like, it can be better, but there is also a lot of beauty there, and the beauty can get lost when those particular systems have not benefited us. So we are kind of like, I'm not really getting anything out of this system, so why not take a deeper dive into it and see what parts of the system are necessary. But it still kind of goes back to that same kind of thing. It's like we got lost in a system and we wanted to do better. And this kind of actually like very easily transitions into the topic of privilege to some extent, because having working class, you know, immigrant families and coming into this new environment, part of it is the privilege that we get to go to the desert to find ourselves.
Yeah.
Right?
Oh, yeah.
It's not cheap to go find yourself.
No.
It's like that, the topic of like, why is Burning Man so white? Like, from, you know, it, it's Maslow's hierarchy of needs.
Could be a whole podcast episode.
Yeah. It has been. Yeah. 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 But yeah, and so that kind of transitions into therapy. Like there is, I guess the note that I had here, and I want your thoughts on this, is that the thought does exist for a lot of people that investing, on some level, the thought is there, investing in mental health is to some extent a luxury because the power bill is fucking real. How am I supposed to set aside, let's say, what, 2 sessions a month comes to around $400?
Yeah.
How am I supposed to set $400, $500 aside in addition to losing hours?
Yes.
To go see a stranger that I might not like, by the way. Yeah. We might not have, we might not vibe.
Yeah. Right. Totally.
Those know-it-all therapists and psychologists.
Yeah. Another friend. Yeah. I had another therapist friend actually messaged me privately to say, like, one of the things that also comes up too is if you came from systems like we did, there is also this thought of, I don't want to surrender my will to this other person. Like, especially like people coming from like Mormon upbringings or, you know, like another example that came up from somebody was Scientologist upbringings. Like this thought of like going in to surrender my free will to this person and I'm going to give them money.
Yeah.
Ooh. I know it's true. I mean, I'm going to share a little bit about my identities that I hold, privilege and underserved identity. So I'm Latina. I'm of a darker skin tone. So that colorism really does show up in that space for me every day. Growing up in a low socioeconomic environment, single, you know, being raised by a single mother and also being highly educated, which kind of puts me in the bracket of, you know, being in the space of privilege. And to me, I think that when people come to therapy to see me, they do see that hierarchy. They see me as like the, you're the therapist, you're the person that has privilege in the space. And it is true.
Yeah, there's power dynamics.
Yeah, the power dynamics. Yeah. But first and foremost is, can you see, as from a therapist perspective, as a provider, coming into that space with humility, and not just like regular humility, but I'm talking about also cultural humility, really kind of opens that perspective for people who've never experienced therapy or have ever been therapized, I guess I would say, to be like, oh, okay, I'm just sitting with another human, like right in front of me, and they're just here to provide perspective, because the common misconception about therapy is that people think that therapy is you go in, you word vomit, and then you feel good better about yourself. The therapist will probably give you some type of advice, and then you go home, right? And then it's all nice and tidy. Yeah. But it's not like that.
Or by the way, also, this is the other version that I hear quite often. Yeah. You word vomit, and they just listen and listen, and they don't give you any good feedback. And all I'm doing is going in there, paying them $200 to listen to me.
Yeah. You were talking, Arash, about like extremes, like, and how that's, you know, either way can be problematic. It's like the just listening can be problematic and not giving any guidance, but also the other end of the spectrum, like being overly like, I'm going to tell you what to do because I know what's best for you more than you do. That's also problematic. And like, you know, it's hard to find a therapist that has that balance and that does honor that, you know, we're actually two humans sitting together and navigating together. Yes. That is hard to find.
It's probably a good marker too, right? Like for those who are maybe listening and are actively in the process of looking for someone, maybe that could be a nice foundation to be like, can I actually sit down with this human and feel equal? You know, the therapist is not there to walk in front of you. They're there to walk side by side with you.
Right.
Totally.
I've had like 7 therapists in my life, I think, over the course of the years. That's been like one of the examples I've always, analogy example has been like, look, the therapist is not your project manager. They're your project assistant. You're your project manager. You've got to take that lead. And like, one of the things that I'll do is whenever every therapist I've had, the very first thing that I would tell them, the very first session is like, listen, I need you to pull no fucking punches with me. I'm ready to grow. I'm ready to move to the next thing. don't baby coddle me, like, let's do this. And they'll be like, cool, thank you for letting me know, like, how I can go about this. Because usually the first few sessions are just the therapist trying to get an angle on how you communicate and what, you know, how to navigate you.
Yes.
Right, totally.
I love that. And in therapy in general, there is going to be growing pains, right? If you want to experience growth and development in that setting, there are going to be growing pains. And the idea of someone telling you like how it is or how they're seeing things from their perspective or calling you out on your BS, like it's something that would, I my perspective is like, I think a way that would be helpful and healthy to get some perspective within that, that therapeutic space. I don't know. What do you think?
How are, how do you feel like when you're interacting with a new patient or client, like, are you, is there like a number in your head for how many sessions it takes for you to get like an angle on that person? You're both,
we're both shaking our heads with our eyes closed.
Tell me about that.
Well, I think, you know, in the concept of like humility and cultural humility, within that and with the groundwork of that is that every individual is unique, and there's so many ways to explain, you know, what that means. But every person is a complex being with a whole life story and a multitude of life experiences related to their culture, related to, you know, where they live, related to what they do and just aspects of who they are. And, you know, every unfolding process of getting to know that complex being is wildly different from the next. And so, you know, this is kind of reminding me back to our conversation about frustrations with insurance. They want to prescribe, like, you have one intake session, maybe two sessions after that can still be treatment planning, and then it's got to be now you're doing the thing that you've prescribed. And it's like, that's also a frustrating thing that you have to work within when you take insurance, because that's not like that's not what humans are. We're not machines that you figure out in 90 minutes.
We're dynamic.
And sometimes I find that I, you know, feel connected to someone in one session, and sometimes like 5-10 sessions later, we really feel like we've gotten to know each other. And, and just to be able to be patient and allow that to unfold naturally.
So that's a good question. That's excellent, you know? Because that is the kind of like a concern that comes up is like, what, I got to do 5 or 10 sessions with you before I start to see
which
anything?
I understand that too. And it's just like, all sides are valid, you know, it's so
all
hard.
So true.
Because that's one of the, a lot of the stuff that I'm going to be sharing, by the way, for listeners is, it's not just one person who said it, unless I quote that one person. This has come from multiple angles. But one of the examples that came up was my experience is very unique. I guess the idea being that that this person's experience is incredibly unique, and that it takes a really, really long time to get all of the story out. And until you even get all of that story out, there is no value to the therapy.
That's so interesting that you say that, because for us, like at least for me, what's coming up is the content versus process experience, right?
Yeah.
So there's like the story, which tells all the juicy details about the breakup or the traumas. But at the end of the day, the process has like a general theme, and underlining that story, there's going to be trends within the way that we cope, within like the outcome of those stories, which is really interesting. And so that part of like, and maybe this is not something that you'll only have to do in therapy, but can also be helpful when you're doing your self work, which I'm a big proponent of self work, is start looking at your trends, like get a sense of like, oh yes, the story is going to be different because it happened in the context of work, or it happened in the context of a relationship. But what is the outcome? What is the process? What is the trend underlining that maybe gives you insight on areas, patterns, areas where you can grow.
Yeah.
I think content versus process is a massive topic.
For sure.
And, I'm going to stumble through explaining this a little bit, but I want you to talk about this a little bit more.
Yeah.
Because there's a general observation I have had in my life experience that, and this is a community, specifically the burner community, I'm going to say, is very, again, densely populated by incredibly intelligent people.
Yes, mm-hmm. I love it.
And intelligence is mm-hmm. amazing. Intelligence moves so many things forward. Intelligence can also be possibly, in my observations, the most efficient precursor to depression that I can think of, because like that focus on content, like the being incredibly articulate for arguing for one's limitations,
living in the left brain.
Yeah, for sure. But yeah, but that content versus process, like, tell me some more about the good stuff that can come from the process that can potentially get some of our focus off of content.
Well, I'm thinking of our conversation earlier that we were just kind of, you know, spitballing before and talking about our addiction to certainty. And like, you know, I think this is part of, you know, American culture that is so damaging, where we are very disconnected from our emotions and, you know, yeah, we're all about results. And I mean, this is part of capitalism, right? It's like the product, the outcome, the content, and the certainty, and we need this answer, and we need this particular thing. And while that's helpful, and intelligence, like we've talked about, is really valuable and wonderful and can, you know, lead to amazing creations and things like that. Moving away from process and into like content and outcome and product and results, it disconnects us from our emotional side and our creative side and our side that dreams and you know, daydreams and gets inspired. And you know, when we're so cut off from that part of ourselves, you know, of course, depression's going to be easier to fall into. We're so numb sometimes when we're just living in like intellectual world, and you know, like left brain world.
You know what this is making me think of? It's like like the conversation of when does foreplay begin? And like, you know, you like a lot of times like men are like, you know, when you're in bed and your clothes are off, like, no, foreplay started 3 weeks ago.
When you wake up that morning.
When you made eye contact for 5 seconds.
With the aspect of, you know, Mia was talking about the addiction to certainty that we have, but also the addiction to immediacy, you know, wanting things right now.
Totally.
The impatience.
The impatience and like fix me urgency. Now. Just give me this thing and fix me now is very real. So this is part of what comes up a lot in therapy, where people come in and they're like, okay, I'm here. I showed up. I'm doing the thing. How long do I have to do this to be okay and move on with our lives, right? And although self-efficacy is something that, you know, I am a big proponent of, you know, self-efficacy, meaning how confident and comfortable are you in your ability to thrive in day-to-day, in day-to-day life, right? And so when you are so in a hurry to try to be in that space of self-efficacy or to try to like just do the thing so you can move on and do other better things, right? It, you get caught in the cycle. And
I'm thinking of like just, you know, with that mindset, you are already, you know, let me do this thing to get there. Let me be at that result already, and not actually being present in the process that would have gotten you there. You just want to skip that and like do the thing to get there.
But the process is so beautiful.
But the process is what actually gets you there. It's like a trap.
It also doesn't last in my experience. Like if you don't actually, I mean, I can't speak you. What I have experienced is that when it's, for lack of a better description, when it's a magic pill, it's likely not to last as long.
For sure.
One of the notes that I had was a phrase that I've just fallen in love with was, an addiction to catharsis, which was which is the name of a previous episode. It was said by Micaiah Duell.
Can you elaborate on that?
Addiction to catharsis is something that is very prevalent in our community. And it's, you do the DMT and you have big explosions and fireworks and oh my God, I see everything differently yeah. now. My life has changed. And then when you get into doing the day-to-day work, it's mm-hmm. just not as exciting. So you yeah. keep going after that same, you want the fireworks.
Yeah.
You
yeah.
want the explosions. You want to yeah. like run out into the yes. field and go, I saw this big thing. But yeah. then like the day-to-day boring work, like yeah. I got to sit down and meditate every morning.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
uh-huh. I got to yeah. journal. Like, I don't really have anything to journal about today. Like
yeah.
all of that. And that is something that yeah. we... this community, with navigating this community with all the love and support and amazingness it has, it also has that potential pitfall.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The process versus content, I think, like, it still kind of always goes back to that, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because I think a lot of times that catharsis experience can bring your awareness to the content.
Mm.
But it still hasn't implemented the process.
Yes.
Yeah. It should inspire the process.
Right.
Maybe
right.
you can have this big breakthrough moment. Those are very valuable and deserve to be celebrated, of course. It's not to discount how amazing those moments can yeah. be, whether it's with the psychedelic experience or just a breakthrough in therapy or a light bulb moment or, you know, a realization about yourself. But of course, yeah, what that should inspire then yes. is like an integration process, yes. a process of what am I going to do with this? Yeah. And how am I going to bring this into my mundane daily actions yeah. and, you know, have it inspire more embodied change.
Yeah. Yeah. I want to take this opportunity to kind of like remind listeners again that like a lot of the stuff that we're talking about, we're not necessarily addressing in detail, like, you know, folks who literally have like a dime to their name and they're navigating systems trying to get care and they don't have, like, they're not able to afford it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's beyond the scope of this podcast to address every single thing that is systematically wrong with our healthcare.
Yeah. Yeah.
But yeah, certainly there are, but what that kind of like navigates to is, I wish I could find this quote that somebody, shared, 'cause I really loved how they worded it.
Mm.
They said, basically the process, oh, here it is. The steps it takes to seek care are all things that I have trouble with and the reason I need mental health in the first place.
Mm-hmm.
It's a paradox.
Yeah. I love that. That's, yes, it's all a process, right? And to me, you know, going back to the systemic aspects of healthcare, mental health care, and the, inequities that are within that. Mm-hmm. To me, I just, one of the things that got me into this career is my own wish to help increase like-minded people, like people who look like me in those spaces.
Mm-hmm.
Actively, I think the last time I read the research, it said that I think out of all the psychologists in the U.S., only 8% of those are identified as Latinx,
mm.
and probably about 5 or maybe even less percent are Latinx individuals who speak Spanish.
Mm.
So for me, it's become really important as a person who is of a minority status, not just in my ethnic and racial identity, but also my sexual orientation. I find that if I can strive to be in that space and help inform decisions to help close some of those inequity gaps, to me is gonna hopefully, but that's mm-hmm. future Mayra just wanting sure. to, you know, lessen those gaps and help support those communities.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Like, is the I'm putting myself in the place of a person who's trying to like get it together, like to, you know, to get into like yeah. therapy, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah, I guess like one of those 10,000 things that is working against me potentially is, do I feel a connection with the people that I am communicating with?
Mm-hmm.
And if it feels like it's a yeah. system of people that don't, for lack of a better description, look like me, it does make it that much harder, because it's already hard. It's hard enough to get the fuck up in the morning
yeah,
and
yeah.
like do the thing, right?
But
like if add to the 10,000 things that make it difficult to navigate that yeah. is, do I feel a cultural connection?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Is there a sense of belonging mm-hmm. in that space?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And maybe that, I don't know what it's been like for you, Arash and Mia, like in being in the Burning Man space in your intersecting identities, but it is there are, I really appreciate that Burning Man's increasing a focus around, like, let's bring more, like, mm-hmm. more diverse people in the space as leaders, as artists, mm-hmm. as a community group. Yeah. And at times, even as a brown woman, I find myself, I don't know, just, like, having to, like, show up more to represent the identities that I hold. Mm-hmm. And it's just, like, kind yeah. of a weird thing to do.
Yeah, identity politics. Yeah, yeah that's yeah. a... That one is definitely another podcast yes. episode that mm-hmm. we'll yeah. fully get into. Totally. I want to know, off the top of your head, do you have any thoughts, like, on the foreplay topic, right? Like, I'm trying to get into this thing. I'm trying to get yeah. it together. I am depression. That's the fucked up part of depression, is that, like, it doesn't give you the juice that you need to just, like, yeah. get up and go after a thing.
Yeah.
If I am a person navigating that, and I'm trying to figure out where to even start, what are some thoughts that you have on where to even start?
We all love foreplay, but foreplay sometimes takes a lot of work.
Yeah, yeah, and a lot of it's thought and intention yeah. and presence and the things that are mm-hmm. hard sometimes. I just want to first name and validate the, like, specific difficulties with a depression type of mental health challenge. You know, there's all different ways that we struggle with mental health, and some are more activating, like anxiety, and some are more heavy and debilitating and stuck, like depression. And I just want to name how challenging that is, and all of us that have felt that really know that it's like, yes, I want to start doing this thing, but yeah, the whole nature of my problem, as you said, Arash, is sometimes like that I do feel stuck and I can't have the juice to take action. And so it's hard to say, like, here's five things you can do, because it's like, yeah, if you're in that state, it's mm-hmm. you sometimes don't have the energy to do anything. One thing that's coming up for me is that sometimes a deep depression is asking us to slow down and really just be with our emotions. And of course, we don't want to get stuck there for too long, but I do think, like, sometimes you don't need to force yourself to do anything right away, and you can, and just kind of be with whatever these really awful feelings are, and be curious about them. And really try to sit with, you know, what is coming up for you. In terms of, like, being inspired to take action, sometimes there is just a lot of, like, forcing, like, yes. if you can just, like, force yourself to
fake it till you make it,
call one person, yeah. or at least ask a friend to help you call one person, you know, ask for help if it's harder for you to do that. Maybe just take one baby step,
yeah.
and sometimes it's forcing. It's really yeah. hard with depression.
Yeah.
The
way that I like to think about this. So also, like, there's not just one way to start right. taking action, right? Like, you totally. Can take a multimodal approach. By that, I mean, just what are the things that you care about? What are your values? And maybe come in from that place. I value my body. Great. Okay. So what does that look like? Okay. I value moving my body. I value exercising. Okay. Then if you know that's an avenue to take, how can you incorporate that into your toolbox? Mm-hmm. So for me, I like to come in from a values perspective, because mm-hmm. If you find something that's really important for you, that can be that little, like, fire that gets lit under your butt to kind of start taking action. And sometimes, well, the big question, if you take a step back, is like, what if I don't know my values? Like,
yeah, or you feel numb to them yes. at that time.
Yeah, I don't feel connected to my values. Yeah. I lost a sense of what that means or what that looks like for me.
I think that, you know, in that, coming from someone who's been in that place, I've had really, really deep depression episodes and been suicidal myself in the past. And, yeah, like, just being able to get to a space, whether it's with a therapist or a friend or someone where you are connecting, even if you don't know what your values are and you don't know if you want to live and you don't know what's important, I do think connection can be that little fire as well. Mm-hmm. If values, yes. I'm like definitely connected to values as well, but if you're feeling disconnected from values, any kind of connection can be that little little glimmer of like hope.
Absolutely.
Again, whether that's with a friend or a therapist or a peer support or community or, you know, a mentor or anyone.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And this kind of goes back to the process conversation because, like for me, like I'm thinking about things like the cornerstones of my mental health practices. Mm. And for me, it's meditation and morning pages. Mm. I write 3 pages every morning, come hell or high water.
Yeah.
A great chunk of the time, it's a bunch of crap. Like, it's like,
scribbling.
Fluff.
It's totally fluff. But I've done it enough times to see that value comes out of it, and it doesn't come out of it 100% of the time.
Yeah.
And the same thing with like meditation. Like,
yeah.
I've had this conversation countless times where a person is expressing that they have a logical awareness that there's value in it, but they can't seem to come around to seeing value and taking a step in that direction.
Yeah.
And I'm like, you don't need to sit for an hour a day. Yeah. Start with 2 minutes.
Literally. Like, 30 seconds.
Yeah.
Like
30 seconds.
Seriously.
But just make it like you take longer than that to brush your teeth.
Yeah.
But start doing that. And then in a month, make it 35 seconds.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
Be flexible.
Yeah.
Flexible with your approach is a key one, mm-hmm. right?
And
patience and compassion and all those things we're so good at doing to other people and for others, but we are hardly like that kind to ourselves. Mm-hmm. And so it's okay if you today you feel like crap and you just want to watch like Netflix and chill or Netflix and binge, do it. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's okay.
Yeah.
It's okay. Mm-hmm. Really, guys, it's okay.
Yeah.
Right. And
like when we say baby steps, like little infant, newborn, tiny baby steps, like, that can be so powerful. It's like we look at when someone makes a big change and, you know, sometimes at the end of the road, you're like, oh, that just happened overnight. This big explosion happened. But when you actually ask that person everything that led up to that, it's tiny little teeny moments, you know.
Yeah. But only people see the outside.
Right.
Only people see the big reveal, right? And it's sexy and it looks good and every people like strive for that, but it
and the baby steps aren't always sexy.
Yes, exactly.
They're often really hard and weird and messy and small and not that satisfying right away.
So it's funny because like that basically leads back to like that frustration that people are expressing when they're trying to access therapy and they're having a difficult time because they don't know where to start, yada yada. But like it's almost like, and please correct me if I'm misarticulating this, but it kind of seems to me like the baby steps are the everyday decisions that we're making, and the big sexy reveal is that 2 times a month for an hour that you're having the therapy session and you can say, I am in therapy.
I love that so much, Arash, because yes, and I like to explain this to the people that I work with is like you only get 1 hour, 50-minute session with me, but yet you're living the other 23 hours and 10 minutes out in the world. Mm-hmm. So what are you doing in that time when you're out in your day-to-day living your life? And that 1 hour, 50 minutes that you spend with me is not going to fix anything, but it could be a space where you can bring in what's been going on and gain some tools and begin to reintegrate that information or that insight or whatever into your day-to-day life.
Yeah. And I when we were chatting about this episode the other night, Mayra, leading up to it in my mind, this was going to be like entirely focused on, you know, therapy, which is why like the original title of it was Why Aren't You in Therapy? But then, you very quickly brought to my awareness, like how that's like such a small, that's the tip of the iceberg of this journey.
Yeah.
And the phrase you shared with me, which I was not familiar with till now, was the gold standard.
Yes.
Which is what is it? Independent, third party, unbiased?
Yeah, like the gold standard is, we use it in research a lot, which is like, this is like evidence based. This is like what we all strive for. Mm-hmm. Like if I can be a little bit more broad in that definition. But yeah, the idea, the gold standard is that would all have a therapist that we'd be working with. To me, that's a gold standard.
Yeah.
But it's 99.9% of the time we don't have accessibility to the gold standard. And if we can be frank, like, our job is not to be in therapy forever.
Right.
Yeah. But hey, we want to, you know, gain insight, like gain like a boost in our self-efficacy, and then move on and keep being our awesome selves. Right.
Yeah. My only like two not great experiences with therapy. Mm-hmm. One of them was actually, and this is kind of interesting. A therapist that I saw was at the San Diego State, and it's therapists who are still getting their hours in for like licensing.
Mm-hmm. Right.
A lot of folks immediately like, I don't want to waste my time with somebody who's not already blah, blah, blah. No. I've had lovely experiences with therapists that are still putting in their hours. The one that I saw at San Diego State was a Turkish guy. He was younger than me. And I remember as soon as I walked in there, I'm like, this motherfucker is like a kid.
Yeah.
And I'm supposed to take life.
We've been that kid.
Yeah.
That everyone's immediately pissed off at, but then warms up to.
Totally. No, I thankfully my mind went to the analogy of like, well, I mean, I don't need my mechanic to be my homeboy.
Yeah.
Like, I just need them to know how to fix the car. So this person's done the training. I'm going to trust this. Yeah. Ended up being amazing. He gave me like some of the biggest revelations. He had a cultural understanding that he was able to convey that no other therapist I've seen has been able to convey.
And
what they would do is that they would record the sessions and he'd review it with his professor.
Yeah.
And then he basically was like, I feel like we've kind of given you all the tools. So you got to, you know, go fly, little birdie.
Go
do things now.
Yes.
And I was like, but I want to stay in therapy because this feels really good. And then like, so he cycled out of there, and like the next person that came in was like, had no, she's like, I don't really know what I'm supposed to do with you. Like, we've already gone through all this. Yeah. You've been given very specific tools to go work with. Professor's like, nah, he's fine. But literally they kept seeing me because I kept saying I wanted to go in. But after a few sessions, I'm like, oh, you're right. I'm not getting anything out of this.
Yeah. Yeah, that's part of psychology ethics, is to know when a person seems to be like, you know, have gotten what they need in this particular process, and to not keep them in therapy for longer than they need to, because it's an investment of their time and money. And so it actually is, I think it's a mark of a good therapist to be like, okay, I think you go live your life now. So sometimes I think people feel like sad by that. Like, well, wait, I wanted to work together forever. But it's also like, we want to honor your self-efficacy and let you go be in the world and not have to rely on us and keep investing your time and money. So
that in itself can be a learning opportunity of like, when is it okay to let go?
And that can be a really healing experience too.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's so interesting. I'm kind of like looking through my notes, because what's happening is that we are very organically like hitting all of them.
Yeah.
And a big chunk of the interesting parts of the conversation is like, we're addressing a lot of misconceptions.
Yeah.
Which I'm loving. We got
debunking the myths of therapy. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Maybe that should be the title.
Yeah. It's really so fascinating, because like when we're having this conversation, really it is like illuminating and unveiling that like a lot of the frustrations are deeply intertwined with the misconceptions of what therapy is supposed to be.
Yeah.
And what self-care is supposed to be, and how this whole process works.
Yeah. Can I name something really quick?
Please.
We kind of have touched on it here and there, and it's just coming up for me in my heart again. And, you know, just going back to like systems and barriers and access and all these things, and how we're talking about, it's so important to honor the process and baby steps and slowness, and like, just want to name how much harder it is to be able to settle into that space when you are financially limited, you have barriers to care, and, you know, three jobs you're working. And, you know, I just want to give listeners a reminder that, like, yes, all of that is a barrier to being able to show up to therapy in the way that is most ideal. And like, you know, that's not your fault. That's
100%.
Like,
and if doing therapy or, you know, going to therapy does not align with you at the time, it's okay as well.
Yeah,
right.
Totally.
Another when I guess you had invited me to do this podcast, Arash, one of the things that was coming up for me is like, wow, like, you know, it's not just about therapy, but it's about like, how can you integrate maybe a therapy mindset within your day-to-day life?
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And everyone has the capacity to do that in their own way, whether it's through self-education, reading, connecting with friends, writing and journaling. There are many opportunities. Yeah. Teaching, I often find that like teaching is the best way that you can learn a lot about yourself and maybe whatever content or process you're
Explain something to somebody else is the fastest way that you learn that you don't know shit about what it is you're talking about, or you know a lot about it.
Exactly. So there are many avenues to self-care and self-love and that expansion of the self that we can all explore. So therapy is one avenue, but it's like you said earlier, it's not the panacea.
It seems like what's kind of unveiling as we're having this conversation is that there is there's sort of where a lot of folks are at, which is like trying to get through their day to day, and they have probably like some self-care processes that they have implemented. You know, we all have some stuff that we're doing, and then you have the gold standard, which is that you have an independent, unbiased person that you are seeing weekly, right? Yeah. And I guess what we're navigating is that there's this entire middle area that we can work to develop, which you just kind of named as the therapy mindset, which I think is incredibly valuable, and I just have not really thought about till right now as we're having this exchange.
Yeah,
I feel like organically we all kind of do that, right? Like it's part of that self-preservation piece.
Well, that might be the thing though. I'm saying like that might be the bubble that I live in that I was referencing in the intro.
Yeah.
Because like my inner circles are predominantly populated by people doing that. Yeah. And every once in a while, I have a lot of friends, a lot of different communities, but every once in a while I get into like a topic like this, right? Yeah. With somebody outside of my inner circle. Yeah. And I'm like, oh shit. This is not normal. Like, it's not, the whole world doesn't think this way.
There's stigma. Stigma is real.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I also would love to see, and I do see this, and Mayra, I'd love to hear if you see this too, even throughout the, you know, less than a decade that I've been doing therapy work, I've seen a shift in like the greater culture of like therapy mindset, where just, you know, talking about trauma and depression and challenges is becoming a little more normalized in the greater culture. And I would love to see that continue to the point where maybe you wouldn't need to see a therapist all the time. I would love for our jobs to not become as necessary and for people to just be living these things within their friend circles and their communities. And I do see it happening more, especially with like younger generations. And it's really cool to see just like, just casual day-to-day conversations, like including mental health, not having to wait till you get to the therapy room to like talk about those things. So really hope to see that.
I have seen that as well.
Trickle out more.
Very special.
Yeah.
I've seen that, you know, I've done a lot of my training has been in the VA working with veterans. And I've seen that in younger folk, like people who just got discharged from their service and are happy to see a therapist, which is like there's added stigma with that population. So
absolutely
seeing that bubble through in that setting with those and with those type of individuals has also been really refreshing. But I'm also even seeing it with the older generation, right? And they're like, oh, I've never spoken with anybody about my mental health, or I've never talked about these things, and now I'm starting to feel comfortable because maybe it's social media is like, I feel like our social media too is like being more open about self-care, you know, mental health and our those mental health, not just like it's all pretty or everything, like our mishaps are there. And because we're seeing that more, I think we're starting to feel more comfortable. So that is a breath of fresh air for me.
100%. Yeah, I agree.
Yeah.
I agree. That was, especially in this, you know, as I started to navigate the burner community, that was for me the biggest thing that made me go, oh shit, these are my people.
Yeah.
Was that no matter what topic I got into, I was not the weird guy at the party.
Yeah.
And
everything's welcome.
Refreshing. Yeah. Yeah. I personally found that I would get more euphoric being able to talk about stuff like this casually. Yeah.
Totally.
In like a party environment.
Yeah.
And even that, this was a thing that I was going to mention earlier when we were talking about the cultural background aspects. Mm-hmm. So there's like, this is like an image to me of what I'm about to convey. Fat Tuesday is like right before Ash Wednesday, right?
Mm, right.
And like Fat Tuesday, the idea is like you go and get all your partying out of your system so that Ash Wednesday you can be serious.
Yeah.
And work on the spiritual stuff because that's serious stuff.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I'm making fun of it in my tone. and that was the biggest thing that got me like fully plugged in to the burner community, that I saw like, oh, there isn't a differentiation between when I'm healing and growing and when I'm having fun.
Yeah. I love that.
Totally.
That was what hooked me.
Yeah. That was pretty life changing for me too, in a different way, for sure. For all of us, you know, it's like so beautiful to be able to just, do all those things in the same place.
Yeah. One that popped up, a question. Some variation of this question popped up in one way or another. I'm too smart for my therapist, or I feel like I have outgrown my therapist. Mm-hmm. What does that look like from like your end? Have you had experiences like that? Is that even a factor?
Interesting. I don't know. I'm going to defer to Mia for this, but I'm going to think about this a little bit longer.
I mentioned earlier, for me, it's the mechanic thing. Yeah. I'm like, right. You're my mechanic. Do the job. Right. You're doing a job.
What comes up for me first is like, how are you defining smart? Mm-hmm. Everyone's going to know things that you don't know, and they're going to know things that, or you're going to know things that they don't know, and vice versa. Whatever. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Coming into a space where you're like, I'm smarter than this person. You probably are in some regard. But also being open to maybe they know something totally different that I'm unaware of, that they know more than I do. And that might be just the type of approach. When it comes to like your experience, Arash, like, oh, this younger person, I was laughing because like, Mayra and I have been the trainees in the student health clinics that were, having people who are older than us come in and immediately, have a look on their face. But I think what can be really beautiful, whether it's between therapist and client or just two people on the street, is just to realize that everyone's going to have a unique perspective on something, and it might be wildly different from yours, and that may be interpreted as like not as good, but also like, can we be open and see if maybe it's just such a different perspective that I'm not seeing the value right away, and can we just kind of hear each other? And of course, there might still be a point at which later you're like, no, I actually don't feel a match with this therapist, or maybe I don't like their approach, or maybe they really don't know what they're doing, because that does happen. But just to kind of like challenge that a little bit and see, because with your experience, like you said, Arash, like you ended up actually really liking that person. And maybe like initially, if you would have just walked out, you would have missed out on that. And I've had clients do that where they've like immediately requested another therapist. I mean, I'm 31 now, but I still get told I look like I'm 19. And like, it's always kind of like, oh, well, I thought we could have really worked well together. But, they're just like, no, you look young and dumb because you're smiling. You look too naive. And I'm like, oh, that's really sad. But okay.
That's interesting, because it's like, oh, you don't look like me, or you're not my age. And so again, we're tying back to those, like that part where we're like, oh, we want to relate to the people that we're working with. Right. We want to relate to our therapists. I'm bringing back like working with veterans, because my training has been around aging and chronic disease management, and the people would come in and be like, well, what do you know about what it's like to be 70? What do you know what it's like to have chronic pain? I don't know what it's like to be, but let me provide some perspective. And it's that I think I'm going to bring a word in therapy word or psychology word, cognitive flexibility, that I think is what can promote change. Cognitive flexibility is what can promote change. And I think that's really important, because if you're a little bit more flexible and not so pigeonholed into your, or narrow into your belief systems, then opening up that scope a little bit is going to give you insight, or at least an openness to receive a breath of fresh air, right? And and for those listeners who are maybe feeling hesitant to work with a younger provider, or maybe someone who is not of their gender, you know, try it out. And if it doesn't feel right, it doesn't feel right. And that's okay too, right? Because sometimes energy is real, even if you're doing therapy over telehealth, like you can feel the energy. Yeah. And if the energy just doesn't sit right, it's okay. Like listen to that gut, listen to that part of yourself as well. Yeah. But also, if you are a person that tends to move on very quickly and is like, if you're like just swiping right when you're like dating because you're like, oh, I don't like that shirt or whatever it is, like, so. Yeah. Notice that within yourself. Are you the kind of person that is so dismissive and quickly like says no to things, or quickly like judges things? Like, is that coming up in that space of collaborating with the therapist? And what would it look like if you not went towards that initial instinct, right?
Yeah.
Maybe it would be helpful to name too, like things to look for that could be more like indications that yes, you should change providers. Because I think both are important to like, one is like, be open and see if you could lean in a little bit more. And then obviously the other side is like, when is it like, oh yeah, no, let's not do this. I don't know if you have any thoughts, but I think we both probably have lots of things.
Yes.
But.
Well, I'll say one and then I'll let you take that. But one, if first and foremost, if you find like your therapist is like crossing your boundaries, like that's a big no-no. Like that is ethically not okay. If you feel unsafe in the therapeutic space, that is not okay.
What kind of boundaries might a therapist cross?
Wow. Let me tell you, Arash. The number, what's probably Mia knows the research on this too, but I think like the number one reason a psychologist or a mental health provider might get in trouble and might get their license taken away is for crossing boundaries. That could be like stepping away into the therapy relationship and into maybe a more intimate type of relationship. That's definitely not okay.
Trying to bang your client, not okay.
Yes. You said it very bluntly. But yes.
And the intangible, less versions of that too, where you just feel the energy is shifted and it's uncomfortable. And, you know, that's not okay. Never okay. There's kind of obviously like horrible examples of that. If anything ever feels like sexual boundary crossing or abusive or manipulative or pressuring or anything like that, or making you do things that you don't want to do, even if it's having a conversation you don't want to have, that's also boundary crossing. A therapist should maybe challenge you a little bit, but be like, you know what, if you don't want to go there, that's okay. Like, where do you want to go? You know, and help you lead. But you know, also we were talking about like, you know, judging your therapist and thinking I might not work well with that person. There are some things that you might pick up on right away that maybe are legitimately like, I'm not going to work well with this person. And going back to the identity piece, you know, yes, finding someone who has shared identities, there's a lot of research that shows that that really helps. And like, will result in a stronger therapeutic relationship, especially someone with more cultural humility. But also like if the person is different than you in many identities,
and that can happen a lot.
Are they open? Are they curious about your story? Are they imposing their views and beliefs on you? Are they,
minimizing your experience?
Sometimes I think it's, you know, there's this, all this conversation about like, do not ever discuss politics in the therapy room because you're supposed to be this neutral blank slate. But like people with marginalized identities want to know, like, do you support my humanity or my human rights? Like, yeah. I think that's a valid question.
Yeah.
To kind of ask those things. So I do think there are some things that it's valid to maybe
clear standards to set for yourself. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And then, I think like something that can help with that process, if you're going through the therapy selection experience.
Yeah.
It's probably helpful to have some idea of what it is you're reaching for,
mm-hmm.
and what your intentions are for this therapy, for seeking out a therapist, for seeking out therapy. Is it a general everything's fucked up, or is it like I have a very specific thing I'm working on?
Yeah.
Example that I can share here. I started seeing my most recent therapist. Shout out to Mark, if you're listening, you're amazing. I went in for I was processing really severe grief and navigating like men's health issues.
Mm. Yeah,
and I looked for him. I was looking for a therapist through Teladoc, which, by the way, interesting side note, overwhelmingly white. and so I was looking for a person of color who ideally was LGBTQ identifying. Yeah. One of my reasons for that is that historically when I'm looking for a provider, my hack of the system, hot tip, mm-hmm. This is a personal thing. Yeah. I tend to, I will like, if I need to pick a primary care doctor, for example, I'll try to find a gay doctor.
Yeah.
Because my experience has been they're a lot more understanding of my weird lifestyle.
Yeah.
They tend to be a lot more patient with it. So I was looking for that. And I couldn't find one. And I stepped away from it and I gave it a couple of days to breathe. And then I went back into it and I'm like, you know what? I'm just going to do this like real gut feeling.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know how I ended up on Mark, but he's a cisgender white male.
Yeah.
And I was just like, okay, him, click.
Yeah.
And I'm just going to trust, like, I'm going in specifically for this thing. He had listed, men's health issues.
Mm-hmm.
And we've had an amazing relationship. Mm. I'm
awesome.
I feel absolutely amazing. He's been so helpful figuring things out. We laugh about the differences in how we navigate relationships and monogamy and all these things, right? Like, it's hilarious to us. But, get together and we're focused on the thing
I'm assuming and you tell me if this doesn't happen, but he's naming his privilege in this space, mm-hmm. right?
Oh, absolutely.
I think that's really important if you're in the process of working with a provider who maybe doesn't align with some of your identities, or you have a perception that they may not understand you, if they themselves bring it up and name the thing that's in the room, then I think that could be a great space to kind of open up those dialogues. Or you can bring it up with your therapist. Like, that's sometimes, like, you don't know if you should bring it up, and maybe a little test for yourself is like, oh, what would happen if I were to bring this topic up? And that can give you a good indication early on if it is a good fit.
Oh. Yeah.
So you should you should poke your therapist right in the beginning.
Yes.
Is what you're saying.
Yeah.
Yes.
I like that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because you're you're so right. That is actually a common thing that folks share as well, is that this is kind of connected to like the navigating gifting in the Burning Man community, right? Like, it's amazing how much of an easier time people have giving gifts than receiving gifts.
Mm-hmm.
That often seems to be like the biggest experience that people navigate at Burning Man. So like, even with like therapy, what kind of connection that comes up for me in that is, people will accidentally navigate default world politeness with their therapist, right? And like, a lot of times I'll tell them like, don't be fucking polite. Like, tell them right up front what your needs are.
Yeah.
You're, for lack of a better word, auditioning.
Yeah, don't be coy.
Yeah.
Just go for
it. We're here to be real.
Yeah.
Let it out.
Let out that stuff.
Don't be polite. Yeah. Let them know right away. Yes. Like, politically, are we aligned?
Yeah.
How do you feel about your privilege?
Yeah, totally.
How am I going to feel about your answer about this privilege?
Yeah. And, just also reminding, it's not always the responsibility of the client or the patient to bring that up. Although if your therapist doesn't bring it up, definitely bring it up. But I do think therapists should at this point in time, we all know that we need to be bringing that up and naming what's in the room and naming the differences and just, you know, even the first time that you're meeting and developing the relationship and the rapport, just like bringing up, you know, identity and just mm-hmm. like the differences in identity and how they feel about that and how you feel about that. Mm-hmm. And are there ways that make you feel and concerns that you have about us working together? And just like, yeah, being able to open that space is, mm-hmm. Already gonna be a better place to start from.
Yes.
Than to just be sitting there wondering if they're, you know, understanding you mm-hmm. or, if there's not authenticity in the relationship and people are just kind of wondering and not saying things, therapy's yes. not gonna feel good. It's not gonna work very well.
In the therapy space and in the default world yes. and in the Burning Man world, in all the worlds and dimensions and all the spaces, authenticity and being able to like be your radical self, I think is something that should be, I don't want to say should, but it's something that one, you know, it's important to tap into.
Yeah. And to have the hard, honest conversations about dynamics that are present.
Yes. And if a relationship doesn't feel healthy for you, like, what does that mean? And is it healthy for you to maintain that relationship? Mm. Oftentimes we feel beholden to maintaining those connections because, oh, these are people that, you know, we're in the same camp or we've like collaborated this thing and done this thing together. They're my chosen family. And then that we get kind of stuck in that sometimes.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
We're getting near the end here. I'm going to give some kind of like more quote unquote rapid fire questions, right. Like random stuff that comes up.
Let's go.
Kind of give like faster answers to these and we'll get them off the checklist.
Yeah.
what if, I'm looking for ways to kind of ask these questions without it feeling like it's like one specific person, but it's like generally like a mixture of people that have asked stuff.
Right.
So there's some general sense of it there.
Mm-hmm. If one person has that question, it's most likely that more people have it, right?
Yeah. They're not alone in that. Yeah,
totally.
I don't want to start because I don't know how long I can keep going in therapy because I'm worried that my job might take me somewhere else or this thing might happen or schedules might change.
Hmm. Well, there's the I'm scared of starting period. And then there's the I'm scared of starting because I might be
Answer
things
both.
Might change.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, I think the I'm scared of starting period is a whole huge conversation. Mm-hmm. But the first thing that you said, worried that things might change. I mean, that's always on the table. That things might, there might be the things that you're thinking might change, like my work might move me or blah, blah, blah. But also like there could be something mm-hmm. totally unexpected that's going to happen in 2 weeks that you could have never even dreamed would happen. And that, so, you know, that is a risk. I'm going through that with a client right now that we just started working together and then she had to unexpectedly move to her home state. So we had to kind of stop, but, I don't know. I don't know if there's any way. I don't know, Mayra, what do you think?
Yeah.
I feel like that's just, so it is what it is.
Yeah,
it's unpredictable.
It is unpredictable.
Yeah.
I think being scared to take action, kind of going back to that conversation, it is a lot. But I think that if you're starting to feel like, okay, I want to, but I'm scared, like try it out. And see what it, and you can always back down.
Yeah.
You can always stop.
Yeah.
Right?
And I've noticed too that,
but it's the starting that's hard.
Yeah.
So hard for everything.
Totally. And I've even had, maybe this is encouraging to some listeners too, but, I've had quite a few times, like more than you would think, where I've met with a person one time. And they got a lot out of it and they never came back. And it was just like, oh, I just really needed to like get this story out, or I just needed someone to talk to about this thing. Or we just had a really good, maybe it was an intake, so it was 90 minutes. And we just had a really good long conversation. Mm-hmm. And then they were like, cool. Yeah. I don't think I need anything else.
Yeah.
And like, that's cool too. Like sometimes that happens or sometimes then we talk and then they're like, wait, we discover they're actually looking for a slightly different kind of thing. And then I help them get connected to that thing. And
it's not a contract, right?
Right.
Like once you can stop at any time.
Exactly.
And you'll be surprised what maybe insights you'll get.
Yeah.
I mean, more likely than not, you'll probably gain something out of it. That's my hope. Mm-hmm. Even the knowledge of like, oh yeah, this wasn't right for me. That's still information that you have.
Yeah. Yeah.
So here's the funny thing. I'm going through my notes as you were answering that. We really hit everything.
Yeah.
Like everything, all the stuff that has come up, all the notes that I had, all the input that people had, for the most part, we've really navigated a lot of it. And there's running themes, certainly. I think there is like a huge running theme is about an openness to the experience. Mm-hmm. That's a thing that comes up. Like a note that I had here is like, I've always felt that I know is just like a detrimental statement in so many situations. Like, how about you try this thing? Yeah, I already know. I know how to do that already. Mm-hmm. I've already done this.
Yeah.
Maybe. I'm not disagreeing that that's like a reality, but I definitely personally experienced that the more I was able to put down the shield of I know, the more interesting things came out of it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And things that I learned, and that aspect of our intelligence being our greatest barrier to our mental health is a thing that I think comes up the most in our community.
Yeah.
Here was actually one thing that I kind of wanted we started to poke at and we didn't get too deep into. This is like a very specific thing that I have observed in our community over my 10 years of doing this show.
Wow, 10 years?
It's coming up on a decade.
I remember when you first started.
That trip.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Amazing.
There is a cycle that a lot of folks more in like the, because there's like Burning Man and then there's like the dance music sort of subculture of Burning Man, and it's not all of Burning Man. Mm-hmm. In fact, my version of Burning Man, to be honest, is mostly like geeks and nerds.
How about geeks and nerds who dance?
Totally. Yeah, totally. Geeks and nerds who party. It's the drama club, man.
Yeah.
But specifically, like, I'm going to go, like, deeper down into, like, the techno underground where I'll see a cycle of feeling amazing on the weekends and then feeling shitty for a couple of days as you're recovering.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And then feeling better and associating that feeling solely to whatever substances it was that you did that weekend and thinking, oh, I just need to make it to Wednesday and I'm fine.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I feel like it's a much more complex conversation. And I think a lot of times it seems like because they feel better 48 hours later, they're like, I'm fine.
Right.
Yeah. That crushing depression that I was feeling, it was only because of the pill and nothing else.
Yeah.
Anyway, I wonder if you have any thoughts on that.
I think I'm just thinking that there are a lot of things that come up for the self when we're in the presence of like a party space, and certainly substances and dynamics and that setting that we've been like talking about have an influence on what comes up internally. Also the kind of state of mind and the emotional state that we're stepping into those spaces. So all that's going to have an influence on the effects during and the effects after you are taken out of that space and, you know, the week starts or whatever that looks like for you. So I just want to name that it's a multimodal process and there's a lot of things that are having an impact on that, and to solely just make the assumption that it's one substance can be a disservice to the self, I think. Mm. But maybe it is that, hey, every time I do this or every time that I'm with these type of people, this comes up for me. That's a data point for you to kind of check in within yourself. I don't know.
Something that's coming up for me is like the behavior versus the function of the behavior. So like I went to a party and then I felt better. Okay, that's maybe what you're picking up from, you know, what happened. But like why do you feel better? What about that made you feel better? Was it because you were escaping your feelings, or was it because you were connecting with community and remembering how to enjoy yourself? Like, those are two very different functions of the behavior, which is the partying. And I think it's really important to reflect upon which function you're experiencing. It's like, you know, I see so much that it's like, so many of us feel that the dance community, the burner community, whatever, you know, even substances have been life-changing in a really positive way. But I think for those of us that have felt that, it's usually because of, you know, it's been with more of a present intention where it's connecting, it's, you know, opening our minds, it's, you know, connecting us to community, it's, you know, all these different things. But for folks that, wait for the weekend to feel better, but it's in a, with a function of escaping, it's with a function of, I just need to feel better about my shitty week. And numbing, hold on
numbing
to
the
that.
Self, yeah.
Right. Like, that's a totally different dynamic, even though from the outside, the behavior might look exactly the same. Mm. And even on the other side, people might be saying the same thing. Oh, I feel better. But it's like, is it like an escaping feel better? Or is it like you're actually doing something meaningful and deep for yourself?
Yeah.
Escape or expansion is the phrase shared with me a few years ago that always stuck with me. And it could, the same substance, the same setting.
Yep.
But if your intention is escape versus expansion, and that builds up over time, has been my experience. The same thing could be expansive a couple of times, and then you might not notice that
now it's an escape.
You fell into that territory without realizing it over the course of a year or two.
Right.
And then there's one day you look back.
That conversation of like spiritual bypassing, which I think is so interesting, because then even sometimes I see people going in with like, no, I am going to use this to expand, but then, and I'm going to transcend. And then it just becomes another form of escaping. Mm. It's like, no, I'm going to expand past all of my, you know, bad things. But it's actually just escapism with like spiritual words on it.
Yeah.
So it's like, it gets like, you know, Yep. Take some reflection.
And it makes me wonder, like, how do you know? How do you know if you're escaping or expanding? And I think the intentionality that you were talking about, it can help contribute to how we're going to navigate that space, like in it and then after the fact. But also, like, it could happen and you just don't know why you maybe tapped into escaping more so than expansion, but maybe once that experience is over and you're reflecting on that, the past weekend or whatever that may look like, are you taking time to reflect and sitting down, you know, or whatever it looks like for you to really understand those past behaviors and the function of those behaviors? And if those behaviors, if you end up, like, if you conclude that, oh, that was an escape, exploring like what was the underlying function of that, and what is it, and
maybe I need to look at that.
And that could be that self-work that we're kind of constantly talking about, of like continue to do things, continue to enjoy life, and then always take moment for reflection and understanding why those checking in why those behaviors happened,
like, it's okay to want to escape once in a while, but like patterns, going back to patterns. Is this the dynamic for me every weekend? Let's look at that. Be curious about that.
That's interesting.
We've
made a pretty good dent, I think, in the conversation.
Fantastic.
I wish we had some stronger systems answers for people, but it's like, it's so... it's such an individual journey. Finding the kind of therapist that you connect with, which, you know, I had a private message, for example, from a friend who wanted to share that they've had really positive experience utilizing Open Path.
There's lots of collectives like that are helpful.
We're going to be, so I want to, my intention is that for this episode was that I want at least like, I can't give you the systems answers. Sorry, dude. Yeah. But what I was hoping that anyone who's listening to this will feel a little bit more seen and heard, if they're having the private struggle. Mm-hmm. And what I hope to do with the show notes of this episode is have like a really robust list of like links and resources.
Yeah, I'm happy to share that.
We got absolutely. You.
Yeah. Yeah. So I want the show notes of this episode to be things that that people in our community could start poking through and feel like they have somewhere to start.
Yeah. Totally.
Finding a therapist, finding support systems, mm-hmm. finding groups, you know, because when you're out there alone.
And low cost options.
Yeah.
Low cost options. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
When you're out there alone in the world, there is, and the other thing too, when like we can't address everybody's mental health problems because everybody's is so different.
Yeah. Yeah.
And the things that people are struggling with are so different, but at least what we can do is hear between, you know, there's three of us here in this room, but there's more people now that are going to be contributing links. Mm-hmm. Hopefully we can give you some place to start poking around, finding someone that might work for you, whether or not you can afford it, maybe you can find something else.
Yeah.
Just the thoughts that I would share. I myself am a starving artist who's like barely making it to next month's rent. There is some value in looking at my monthly budget and going like, all right, I pay this much for electricity. I pay this much for rent. And then I'm going to put aside $200 or $400 a month for therapy. Yeah. And it is a lot for a lot of us. I'm not denying that, but that is, I think, part of the that is the foreplay.
Yeah.
That is the intention. Yeah. And if not, hopefully, there is some low-cost options. There's some community groups we can connect you with.
Ask around. Yeah. Also, you'll be surprised how much maybe your friends or chosen family, all those people can direct you on the right path.
Might know someone.
I know someone.
And be open to it. And my biggest thing is often reminding people, like, be aware of if you're responding to whatever people are saying with, I know.
Mm-hmm.
Or I already did that. I already tried that. I'm not doubting that you did. Nobody's saying that.
Yeah.
But I think like when we get into that mindset, and I'm speaking for myself, I can't speak on behalf of everybody else. I have experienced that when I get into that mindset, I am not hearing openings.
Yeah.
But when I get into an open mindset, I hear better openings.
Yeah.
Beginner's mind.
Yeah. Yeah. Get curious. Yeah.
Get curious.
Get and curious.
Sometimes the same information doesn't hit the same when you hear it every time.
That's huge.
Right. So.
Oh my gosh. That's right there. I was having a text exchange with my brother that was like, it was inflaming. It was like every exchange.
That's a good word.
Yeah, it was inflaming. Yeah. It was about to get bad.
Yeah.
And I stepped away from it. I saw this last text pop up, right? And I stepped away from it. I went to the other room and meditated for like 7 minutes.
Yeah.
And just looked at kind of what came up, paid attention to the feelings in my body. I was like, oh, I'm feeling irritated. I'm feeling anxious. Mm-hmm. I'm going to let go of these things first. Let me get into a good mindset, release the anxiety, release the anger. Mm-hmm. And then I went back and I read his newest text. And it was like a whole different vibe than what I was reading just 10 minutes ago.
Yeah.
I think like just like being able to like practice some of those things can be part of, I'm using foreplay, but like it can be part of the foreplay to help you find your path. Mm-hmm. Anyway, big robust show notes. So look out for that. I'm hoping to give you guys a bunch of links and resources in the notes. But I'm gonna do the little outro thing. You two have been amazing. Thank you so much for this.
Thank you.
It's been
fun.
It's been great.
Yeah.
It has been really, really. I loved it. I got a lot of great ideas out of it. It felt great. And as always, like the best life advice I ever had was from my cousin when I was like 17. He's like, he gave me a book called How to Become a CEO. And he's like, I know you're not interested in being a CEO. All you need is one good idea. You get one good idea out of this book, you are 10 steps ahead of where you were yesterday.
Yeah.
And that's Hopefully you got one good idea out of this chat. That's all I can ask for.
Yeah.
Even if the idea was, I don't ever want to fucking listen to it.
Yes.
Yeah.
Fuck the show.
Yeah. Still information.
Yeah. It's still, you still won. Yeah. You are now listening to the sounds of Umee Dee. So the funny thing is, I'm not actually sure which set this is. She just texted it to me. No, I have not. I'm going to be listening to it. Umee, hold on, here it is. I know that it was a set recorded at Burning Man, and I know that she intermixed it with positive affirmations. Here it is. Declare Your Freedom. It's a melodic house DJ mix with positive affirmations. Which was, I'm going to say it was Burning Man 2017. She played it at, I'm not sure... But you're now listening to the sounds of Umee Dee. It is definitely from Burning Man, I think from 2017. There will be a link in the show notes. You should definitely go find Umee and all the amazing stuff she has to offer to the world. Her website is umeedeemusic.com. That's spelled U, M as in Mary, E-E-E. No, two E's. D as in Delta, E-E, music.com. This link, of course, will be in the show notes. Please share this episode with three friends. Just like text it to them or post it on your social Facebook or something. We don't advertise this show, so any following we have is built strictly on word of mouth from you, our dear listeners. So thank you. We appreciate you. Literally just text a friend and let them know that the longest regularly running traditional podcast in the burner community is this one. And we talk about mental health shit and DJ sets and stuff like that. I don't know. I don't know how you text. I don't know what your life is like. As always, you are invited to pitch interviews in your neck of the woods or throw some dough in the tip jar. All of these links are over at burnerpodcast.com, where you'll also find more podcasts, more shows not hosted by me, and other cool burner content. Burner Podcast has a revolving team of volunteer producers based in various parts of the United States, including Denver, Austin, and Los Angeles. The Burner Podcast theme music is America's Horse with No Name Remix. It is produced by Joman, who just relocated from Denver to Austin, actually. Find more of his music over at soundcloud.com/DJ Joman. So until next time, love, light, and all that other crap, take us back to the playa. Umee Dee.
share your freedom.
Is with you. Feel it, know it, and then act as though it were true. Use to think of failure or to doubt your own power. This mental attitude alone will draw people and things to you. Declare your freedom. Know that no matter what others may say, think, or do, you are a success now, and nothing can hinder you from accomplishing your good. All the power of the universe is with you. Feel it, know it, and then act as though it were true. what others may say, think, or do. You are a success.
Come. Thought is not only power, it is also the form of all things. The conditions that we attract will correspond exactly to our mental pictures. Thoughts of happiness produce cheerfulness instead of depression. Faith, hope, and expectancy. These cheerful, hopeful attitudes of mind are indispensable to the one who really wants to do things in life. Know that no matter what others may say, think, or do, you are a success. Now, and nothing can hinder you from accomplishing your good. All the power of the universe is with you. Feel it, know it, and then act as though it were true.
Thank you. These cheerful, hopeful attitudes of mind are indispensable to the one who really wants to do things in life. Put every negative thought out of your mind once and for all. Declare your freedom. Know that no matter what others may say, think, or do, you are a success now, and nothing can hinder you from accomplishing your good. All the power of the universe is with you. Feel it, know it, and then act as though it were true. Declare your freedom.
burnerpodcast.com.